If I could say a few words to begin, first off, thank you all for your patience tonight. I did not know what time this was going to begin either. It's 3:15 a.m. in Moscow, according to the And I want to say one more thing briefly, which is I understand there was a strike. I was not told that there was a strike that was happening today. And this caused a lot of trouble for all of you who are online. But I'd like to ask you not to hold that against the protesters. Because there's something you need to know. I understand things got heated, you know, words were exchanged, and this is the kind of thing that happens in a democracy. We have uncertainties, we have difficulties, we have inconveniences, but these things are not a weakness, these things are a strength. And although, again, I understand these individuals may have caused difficulty, it was for something that I think we can all agree they must have believed in very strongly. Because it is very, very, very hard, and I know this better than most, to be the least popular person in the room, particularly, and there are many more of the others than there are of you. So just because I can't take a position on the strike because I'm not familiar with the group, I didn't know anything about this, I will say one thing that we can do to help is just let everybody who's on the live stream hear what you in the audience have already, I think, had to confront. Which is the name of this group. I think it's the Association of McGill University Support Employees. And I think they're trying to get a fair wage or something like that. I'd encourage any of you who are connected or impacted by these employees, their groups, or their efforts, to please at least hear them out and go look at the materials. With that said, let's get into it. I'm not going to give you a whole preamble and go sort of through my background, because I think, again, you guys have been waiting on this long, you already know it. But one of the central questions is, you know, why did I come forward, why does it matter, and how does this impact the way we're living now? And I think the central nexus that's affecting everybody the most right now, particularly in this current moment of news, is the fact that we're all being watched, right, regardless of whether we're doing anything right or wrong. And this is a fundamental change, and this is what drove me forward. Traditionally, the work of intelligence services, the work of surveillance agencies, of police investigators, had always been particularly and specifically targeted towards individuals who we had probable cause that had been demonstrated to a court were up to no good. Foreign spies, you know, military units from adversarial nations, these were the guys that we were watching. But with the rise of the internet, right, advances in our science, our understanding of math, the way things are tied together, the communications network, and the way it has sort of swallowed the earth, radically changed the dynamic. Now, surveillance technologies have outpaced democratic controls. Those things that we used to enjoy a generation ago were primarily the product of one particular technological peculiarity, which is that surveillance was expensive, extremely so. Governments had to spend extraordinary sums to track individuals. To know someone's location might involve many teams of officers, both in buildings, behind desks, and those out on the street, working in shifts. I apologize, we've got somebody who just joined the stream.
Barack Obama, Barack Obama.
Basically this dynamic where you had to have whole groups of people tracking one individual. But now, thanks to this rise in technology, that has been reversed entirely. Now, you can have one guy sitting somewhere completely far away from the target, like myself, at the NSA in Hawaii, who can track with extreme precision an unimaginably large number of people. Rather than having whole teams following one person, they have one person following or groups, or individuals. And they don't have to be connected in any way. And this means, for the first time in human history, it's both technologically and financially feasible for governments to track and store nearly complete records of all of our lives. And this is not science fiction. This is happening now. This, not a black screen, this is the massive data repository. The NSA constructed this in Bluffdale, Arizona. It's since been renamed to the Mission Data Repository, because I think they presumed that massive data repository probably wasn't the best brand of 2015. But what does this represent? This represents that shift in dynamic. Now, we never knew what this facility was doing. We never knew why it was created. Governments have not asked for the permission of the public in order to engage in these kind of operations. Instead, they deployed these kind of capabilities in secret, even when they knew these programs were unlawful or unconstitutional, perhaps even because they knew this. And this effort has been enabled because of failures in our intended mechanisms for constitutional oversight of our sort of democratic societies. Courts were unwilling to permit legal challenges against the activities of these spy agencies because they said they were speculation. They could say, well, you can't prove you're spying because it's classified, you don't have access to documents or records. Therefore, we, the courts, even though this could be a violation of your rights or the rights of everyone in the country, don't have a place in this debate because first you have to establish the facts. We had a Congress in the United States that knowingly permitted national security officials to brazenly lie to the public without consequence or even correcting the record. This is a senator in the United States who is questioning the most senior intelligence official in the United States, General James Clapper, the Director of National Intelligence. And it is a felony to give false testimony when you're sworn under oath. But that is exactly what happened in 2013, 3 months before I came forward.
Does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans?
No, sir. Not wittingly. There are cases where they could inadvertently, perhaps, collect, but not willingly.
Unfortunately, that was not true. And this brings us to consider sort of, where does this leave us? Because at the time that happened, the public had no idea it was a lie. The senator asking the question didn't know it was a lie. The director of national intelligence knew that it was a lie as well. We've got someone else who's joining us too. Hopefully the university will get better. But the thing here is, all the powerful people in the room knew this was a lie, but they didn't correct the record. They allowed the public to be deceived, even though it was in fact a crime. The director of national intelligence later admitted this was a false statement, saying it was what he considered the least untruthful thing he had said at the time, and too cute by half. But what does it mean in a democracy where the very foundation of the government, the legitimacy of our system, is derived from the idea that we, when we cast our votes, are providing consent for the government to carry out these policies? Consent, as hopefully everyone in this room can tell you, is only meaningful if it is informed. I get the feeling that we have a live stream somewhere that is displaying things that are allowing people to join. But I hope that all of you who are joining will at least mute your mic.